Hello, welcome to Module 10. We're going to begin talking about hydropower, so creating power through water. And when we start our conversation on this is actually video part four from Module 10, but it's our first video on hydropower. So without further ado, here we go. This is a picture of the Hoover Dam from the backside. So this is Lake Powell behind it. And you can actually see the staining of where the water level used to be and where the water level is now. And hydropower is one of those things that it's incredibly important, and a huge component of the electrical grid system is dependent on hydropower, especially out on the western part of the United States. But it has a lot of environmental issues, and it's something that we have to weigh the consequences of before we go in and build one of these systems because they can be scarring to the landscape. So we have to look at our pros and cons when we choose to do something like a hydropower system. With that said, it's a very old technology. And so this is just a little bit about hydropower technology, and it goes actually way past the Greeks. While we have evidence of Greek water wheels, we know in pictographs that water wheels were used way back at the Egyptians. So once again, we're going back to huge parts of human use well over 2,000 years ago in our set. But as far as understanding and looking at it from an engineering perspective, the first text written about creating energy via hydraulics was written in 1770s. And then you can see that the Army Corps of Engineers took over and established doing things intercontinentally, so things from state to state in 1875. And you can see in 1880, Grand Rapids, Michigan was the first location to have a hydropower station, and they used its electric system to generate lights along there and factories along the roads. Niagara Falls street lamps were being run by hydropowers by 1881. 1882 was the first hydroelectric power plant that began operation and actually sold electricity on the grid. So the other ones were for use based on the location or factory. This one was actually gridded power. By 1886, we can see 45 water-powered electric power plants in the United States and Canada. San Bernardino, California was opened the first hydroelectric power plant on the West Coast and just continuing. So you can just see they came in a row, one after the other. 200 electric power plants were numbered by 1889. So in less than 10 years, we saw this huge growth of 200 power plants built. And then we had to create the Federal Water Powers Act. And that's because we began having damming problems where people were building electric power plants on the waterway that was running on their property, but then they were damming up that water that would then have to go on down to the neighbor's property. And so it had to become something that was federally regulated as opposed to something that was being monitored based on you have a river in your land and therefore you can do what you want with it. Continuing on, by 1907, hydropower provided 15% of the US electric generation. By 1920s, it provided 25% of our needs. By 1935, the Federal Power Commission extended all its authority over electric projects built that were going to be utilities, especially those that were going to have electric lines that were going to run interstate. So even waterways that would run within the state, if that electric line system was going to cross state, there was once again demands for power and arguments, and we had to begin to monitor this on a federal level. From there, the 1937 Bonneville Dam was the first federal dam. This was a project that we knew was going to cross state lines and produce power that was going to make power for multiple states, and therefore, this is our first federally regulated run and created power plant. And by 1940s, hydropower provided 40% of all electrical generation in the United States. That was a 20% growth in, once again, 20 years, very short amount of time. In 1980, we had a conventional capacity for hydropower, which tripled. So we have about triple the amount of hydropower plants in the United States. There's well over 600 hydropower plants. That's not to count dams. There are hundreds of thousands of dams in the United States, all of which are federally registered. So you can actually look them up on government website and see how many are registered and how many are in your area and whether they're really old earthen dams and so on and so forth. But as far as power plants, there's well over 600 federally registered power plants making power on a grid system. Currently, hydropower produces about 10% of our electrical needs for our grid system. The biggest one we have is still Hoover Dam, which was a Depression era project. So now backtracking into water wheels, going back to that early advent of using water to basically turn or just create a mechanical system. And we would turn the water wheel and then we would do something by creating, once again, a shaft structure. This is why we put these subjects together, a shaft structure, which would then turn a system. And so this one's a grindstone system. And so I have my grindstone, which is mounted to the shaft, and the base stone is the one that turns. So this is turning. And then I would drop my grindstone down on top and it would turn underneath the grindstone. And then I could drop grain into the system and it would grind it down. And then I would pull this really heavy grindstone back to expose the grain down on my circular module here. And I would be able to move out or sweep out my grain system. And so that would be grinding grain. We did the same thing to cut wood, right? You think of the sawing systems where we would have my huge saw system hooked up here and would be rotation turning at the speed of the water. And I would feed the wood through my system. And so water wheels. The earliest water wheel systems were horizontal, where we would actually lay the water wheel down into the river. And these were okay systems, but they had a lot of drag and torque and they could get stuck in one direction and they had sediment buildup. And so there was a lot of problems with it. And so the next engineering feat was just to turn that water wheel vertical. So by turning it vertically and setting it in the river and then creating different gear systems to attach to whatever structure or system that I needed, changed the problem of the water wheel getting caught up and creating torque on itself where it would push back and have a little water eddy over here and reduce the amount of rotation that I would receive as it spun. Then we started coming up with different models for water wheels where we would feed the water differently through the system. And so while this is the book in the picture that was provided to you guys, I'm going to show you this one because it makes a lot more sense here. So in this picture, you can actually see the different ways that I could feed the water to create different rotations as needed. And we would do this based on the river, how easy it was for me to get the water down river, what speeds the water was moving at, so my flow rates, whether I had to change that flow rate, whether the flow rate altered based on seasons. So I would choose my vertical water wheel system based on the water available, right? Like the speed of the water available and the seasonality of the water available. And so the overshot system was one where I would have a penstock and the penstock would feed the water up and over the wheel. So overshot, and the wheel would rotate in this direction as we go around. So it would rotate clockwise. Every other water wheel system that I'm showing you here is counterclockwise. Undershot, I would build a penstock and a gate that would hold the water back. So I'm creating kind of a dam structure and I'd feed the water underneath, undershot, right? So the water would flow down underneath. The breast shot comes in at the center. So this is my middle shot system. And this is the one where I would feed the water directly into the side and the weight of the wheel would get pulled down. And this is my breast shot. And then my pitched back is exactly what it sounds like. I'm pitching my penstock back. So I'm pitching the trough that I'm feeding the water down so that it falls on this side of the wheel and rotates down and around. Some little pictures of these vertical wind water designs. So on that note, I'm going to pick up talking about electrical generation now that we've just kind of talked about structures and terminology within hydropower.